Switch little gears, but we'll keep ourselves into lung cancer. So it's a topic for today's this thing. So if you get a patient of, say, lung cancer, because we have discussed this, how to manage biopsy, surgery, we finished chemo, targeted drugs, circumvented what's the standard of care. Now, suppose as on today, if you get a lung cancer patient and with the pandemic around, how do you go about it? So as doctors, it's our general responsibility that we should be in take into consideration this recent running pandemic, and that she will seek on to and stick to the national and the local guidelines. That's very important because we are in a state of health crisis or health emergency. We also need to have specific responsibilities. We can't say that we are oncologists and we will not take part in the coronavirus control. Yes, we need to do. We need to engage ourselves outside our expertise and contribute to the control of the virus. And cancer services, remember, at this point of time may not be a priority, but yes, there's some section of the cancer virus, cancer and in the pandemic where we need to. So there may be some compromise, and all most important is that our patients are very vulnerable because of the immunocompromised status. So if they acquire the virus, it's going to be really bad, and we need to know what is the timely thing that we need to do and how to carry on, because this pandemic is going to continue for another 3 to 4 weeks from henceforth. So recently, I took some of the main points, and also subject to discussion here, we took it, the ASCO has come just 2 days back with the guidelines how to take care of the cancer patient during an COVID-19 pandemic, and what are the frequently asked questions. We'll quickly go through, because it helps us when you go back on Monday, starting from pathology, radiology, surgeons, medical, radiation, oncology, everybody we have with us today in the evening. So it will help us and guide us how to go. Even NHS has also given us the guidelines, how to, the clinical guide for the management of cancer patients, what you should do, what is priority, what you can postpone, what you should not do is also being. So I thought, let's take a case of lung cancer. As on now, we have a patient with us, and how do we proceed? So let's check into these things. People who are undergoing active chemotherapy and radiotherapy are very vulnerable, remember. Those who are with hematological malignancies, leukemia, lymphoma, they are even more, like what myself and Dr. Balaji was speaking about. He has a relapsed AML and I have a relapsed ALL admitted today with emergency. Those on immunotherapy, those on targeted drugs like what you spoke today, and those who undergone stem cell transplant are very vulnerable. And particularly if you had a pulmonary disease, any COPD, if you are a cardiac patient, and if you are at more than 60, that itself is vulnerable in oncology and more vulnerable as far as the COVID-19 is concerned. And that we need to be very careful that this is the thing. Now quickly we'll address surgery, radiation and chemo. Now, sir, your thought process. Suppose a patient is on coming to your OPD. You have one lined up of 10 to 15 patients on a Monday morning with this rise in the incidence of COVID-19. How will your approach to these patients of chemotherapy? They have come for admission on Monday.
I would give preference for adjuvant treatment where the patient is likely to survive. So I would like to postpone the group of patient who is on palliative chemotherapy in good performance status. So I would like to postpone those patients. And patients with immunocompromise, definitely improve the blood picture, and suggestion will be given for them.
Yeah, Dr. Balaji, your opinion, yeah, as heading the unit. What would you, or anything else, you points you want to add? Your mic is there. Adjuvant therapy is your prime modality, like how Dr. Gangadharan has said.
I don't think in the government sitting, we have to treat everyone. We have to finish our OP.
Okay, so sure, yes.
I'm not giving any preference.
Yeah, you're treating everybody as and when,
yes,
they come.
Yes.
You don't send anybody come back 1 week,
yes,
later.
Yes.
Because now we are going to be functioning with skeletal stops everywhere.
Yes. Yeah, in fact, see, in an adjuvant treatment, we cannot compromise on the dose. And those are the patients who go for a myelosuppression.
Yes.
So making them vulnerable for
So as far as adjuvant is concerned, everybody is same priority who walks into the OPD. Yes, like same thing.
In,
I also
in palliation,
agree.
At least I can reduce the dose.
Delay the timing, tell them to come back.
Yes.
Okay. So that's also what the ASCO COVID recommendation says. No specific guidelines, that's what. People do differ, but there is no support that you should delay or reduce the dose of adjuvant. Adjuvant goes as it is because it's a curative option and you should not delay. And always they are saying
there's
use your...
called a triage.
Triage is there. And also you what you need to do is that you need to individualize the patient, see the risk factors and then take a call. But as far as adjuvant is there, there's no guidelines. Now, these patients have been divided up as per the ASCO into five priorities. Like what we discussed, if you are very curative, that is, you have high Hodgkin's.
Before that, we have a hematology, you said hematology cases are more. And almost most of them are treatment cannot be delayed also. And it may not be successful. For example, in an AML relapse, it is almost palliative, but we have a patient who has failed an azacitidine, and I have started him her on D-cetabine. But the thing is, tomorrow there are blood banks. I don't know how
to support.
Support.
That's again a relapse patient. Whether we can delay, whether we can delay the relapse, put on oral.
I don't know how
because scanty services.
Can I skip the second? Second or third dose of D-cetabine. I don't know, but I have asked them to keep a reserved
some blood,
random platelets
for them. Yeah. So now that's it. To divide the cancer into highly curative, like germ cell tumors, testicular tumors, Hodgkin's lymphoma, they are our priority to be admitted. And if you see the priority level 6 is non-curative, metastatic, palliative, sick patient, better to delay and not to tell them to stay back at home, change into oral, go to the local dispensaries for further treatment. And that's how ASCO has divided in medical oncology. So those who are in deep remission, receiving maintenance, you might stop. Like in CML, he's going to visit to get a prescription from imatinib or glivac. In remission, tell them to stay at home, not to visit the OPD, because again, you're a potential candidate for transmission. Okay. Next is to switch from IV to oral chemo for palliative. We can give an oral endoxin, methotrexate, for suppose if the metastatic disease. Withhold chemotherapy, delay chemotherapy, and inform all these patients that there is a hand washing, sanitization has to be done. Suppose a lung cancer patient failed multiple therapy, you can just put them on some oral drugs. Even afatinib is a good drug to send them home, stopping any IV chemotherapy. So that's how the guidelines of.
I have switched over a patient on chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy, 4 cycles completed. But ERK positive, I have switched over to hormone treatment.
Yeah.
I don't know how
Correct. For the time being,
maybe.
For the time being, you are correct.
Okay. Correct, yeah. Maybe after
this
the situation reverses, you can go back and want to complete another 4 chemotherapy. But maybe for the time being. She's not without treatment.
Especially
she's getting.
The patient is old.
Yes. So that's what it is. A clinical decision plays a role and modify the adjuvant treatment. Always they are saying during this period, give everybody growth factors, okay, colony stimulating factors and make them less vulnerable. And you have to balance between what is the benefit of the adjuvant therapy and how much of survival. But if he acquires the infection, then you lose the patient in anemia. So clinical decision is very important. So if a patient coming with fever, it may be neutropenia and fever, so that complicates the whole for a medical oncologist. So again, you have to follow the national guidelines of neutropenia, sepsis, plus national guidelines of COVID-19. So that becomes a little challenging thing where the neutropenia, and they will want to do the coronavirus testing, and I think in corporate hospital is quite expensive. Okay, so that also accounts to it, and along with that anti-cancer treatment. But then you have to allow the national authorities to interfere because of the health crisis.
Yeah, COVID caused lymphopenia and chemotherapy.
Neutropenia.
That's right.
Both.
So neutropenia is what is reported in COVID-19. Thrombocytopenia has not been, lymphopenia has been, and neutrophilia has been reported in COVID-19.
Correct.
Neutrophilia.
Because of inflammation, maybe infection and inflammation. So, fine. So now there is another question posted by Yasco. Do you use prophylactic Tamiflu? Dr. Anand, you can have your thought process. Is Tamiflu should be used, or what is the thought process when you have in an immunocompromised? Yeah, I think data is not matured enough, because Tamiflu is easily available when we use for prevention, but Tamiflu is not recommended not to use it. So that's that. Do not use it, not to be effective in the treatment. Okay. Next is holding chemotherapy from this patient or menu, any thought process? Is there anything which tells you that I will not give the chemotherapy next 1 month? Is there any evidence? I think no data is there to tell them that you have no chemo now, go back, and then I will. So give it, or you change it into oral drugs, or if it is a palliative care, that you can explain, but not in an adjuvant setting. There is no data to say withhold the chemotherapy. Estimated incubation time is, I think, 2 weeks. But I don't know in an immunocompromised how much it is, because that's why sometimes they are saying it's little more before.